with danger, I felt alone. The enemy had singled me out to do me wrong, and when he drew near, my heart filled with fear. Then I heard someone dear calling me to his side, and I ran under his wings. There he called me, and now I can see. The enemy still looks for me, but what he can't see is that I'm under my Lord's wings.
If you stand up for those down on their knees and lend a voice to those who cannot speak,
If you shine a little light, give sight to the ones who've lost their way. There's a place for people like you. I've heard up there the streets are made of gold. And when you get there, there's a hand to hold. I believe when your days down here are through, there's a place up there for people like you. If you walk around with your heart on your sleeve, and if you're trying to be the change you wanna see, if you lay down your life for love so someone could be saved, there's a place for people like you. The streets are made of gold. And when you get there, there's a hand to hold. I believe when your days down here are through, there's a place out there for people like you.
When I was a child, before life removed all the innocence, my father would lift me high and dance with my mother and me, and then spin me around till I fell asleep. Then up stairs he would carry me, and I knew for sure I was loved. If I could get another chance, another walk, another dance with him, I'd play a song that would never ever end. How I'd love, love, to dance with my father again. Ooh. When I and my mother would dance, to him. He'd make me laugh just to comfort me. Yeah, yeah. Then finally make me do just what my mama said. Later that night when I was asleep, he left a dollar under my sheet. Never dreamed that he would be gone from me. If I could steal one final glance, one final step, one final dance with him, I'd play a song that would never ever end. 'Cause I'd love, love, love to dance with my father again. Sometimes I'd listen outside her door, and I'd hear how my mother cried for him. I pray for her even more than me. I pray for her even more than me. I know I'm praying for much too much, but could you send back the only man she loved? I know you don't do it usually, but dear Lord, she's dying to dance with my father again. Every night I fall asleep, and this is all I ever dream.
Shoulders, you raise me up to more than I can be.
Yeah.
when I rise in the morning, when I rise in the morning, when I rise, oh, give me Jesus, give me Jesus, oh, give me Jesus. You can't have all this world, give me Jesus. When I am alone, oh, when I am alone, when I am alone, give me Jesus, give me Jesus, oh, give me Jesus. You can have all. Give me Jesus. Oh, give me Jesus. 'Cause he's all I need. Give me all I need. Oh, it's all I need. Give me Jesus. Oh, in the morning when I rise, when I lay all I need, yeah, yeah, yeah.
worship you. We worship you. Say we worship you, Lord. You're the answer to my prayers. You're the calm in the storm. You're my rest and my refuge. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Oh, yeah, yeah.
one, that we ought to be following the protocols established by the government of St. Lucia. And so as you come in, we want you to spread out yourself as much as possible. If you are not from the same home, you should be spreading yourself, and you will notice that we have put the benches apart from each other. So please spread out yourself and let us as much as possible follow the protocol. Do not congregate together as required by the Ministry of Health, so we could have a successful service here this afternoon. Thank you for adhering to the protocols.
Good afternoon, everyone. Let us all stand for prayer.
You want me to pray? Let us pray. Father, we give you thanks and praise for this day you have given unto us. And whereas we have come here under difficult circumstances, we know that you are with us. So we pray that you will tabernacle with us as we are about to commence, we pray, in Jesus' most wonderful name. Amen. Amen.
Our first song this afternoon is We Speak Of... Please sit, sorry.
Please be seated.
We speak of the realms of the blessed. We speak of the realms of the blessed, that country so bright and so fair, and oft are its glories confessed, but what must it be to be there? We speak of its pathway of gold, its walls decked with jewels so rare, its wonders and pleasures untold, but what must it be to be there? We speak of its freedom from sin, from sorrow, temptation, and care, from trials without and within, but what must it be to be there? We speak of its service of love, of the robes which the glorified wear, of the church of the firstborn above, but what must it be to be there? Our mourning is all at an end when raised by the life-giving word.
As we sing our entrance hymn, when we all get to heaven. Let's all stand as the pallbearers will roll in the casket. Let the lands give us the pitch. Okay. When we all get to heaven, it's in your song sheet.
Thank you.
to ask you to remain standing as we are about to sing our opening song. But first of all, on behalf of the pastor and the administration of the Labi SDA Church and the family of Brother Simmons James, it's my privilege to welcome you here this afternoon. I know it's not a very pleasant situation when your loved one has passed by, but it's part of life, my brothers and sisters, and the most we could do is for us to come together to strengthen the family. So by your shared numbers here this afternoon, and those of you who are watching online, you are saying to the family, I am here to support you, and that means a lot to persons who are mourning the loss of loved ones. And you will agree with me, we have done that a lot during the past 2 years, even because of the COVID situation. But the important thing is for us to be there to support the families. And so I want to welcome you here this afternoon. And I trust that everything that will be said and done here would give courage to somebody to know that there is a God, in spite of all the difficulties, there is a God who is bigger than life, who has conquered death. And one of these good days, even death itself, will disappear as God ushering a brand new world for all of us. So at this point in time, let us all continue our singing with the song Under His Wings, I Am Safely Abiding.
Yeah. remain standing and thank you for your wonderful singing. At this time, we will pray. Let me invite you to please bow your head as we pray. Our eternal loving Father, our Maker, our Creator, and our soon coming King, we thank you for our Lord Jesus Christ, who you sent to this earth, who has conquered death on our behalf. And because you have Jesus Christ has conquered death on our behalf, we have this blessed hope that one day sin and suffering and pain will be no more. One day we shall live and reign with you throughout eternity. And we thank you, Lord, because this is the hope that we have in our Lord Jesus Christ. We pray, Lord, that you'll bring comfort and peace to the heart of the brothers and sisters who are mourning the loss of their loved one. We pray that you'll be with us in this special service. We pray for your presence to beat back the powers of darkness. And may this place be a place where your presence is being felt. And at the end of this service, may someone find Jesus and may someone repent from his or her sins. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Can you kindly sit? Let's turn our leaflets so that we will sing song number. It's not song number, but it will be God Will Take Care of You. I'm so used to the hymnal. Towards the back of your leaflet.
We wait for our musician who just stepped in on our behalf. We want to thank Brother Lance for coming in on behalf of the musician.
Care.
Now it's time for a tribute. And the elder who was supposed to have done the tribute is not here. He's not well, and so he felt it's best to stay away. But I happen to know Brother Simmons sufficiently. He has asked me to do it on his behalf. And I happen to know Brother Simmons maybe a little more than he does. I could tell you our time goes way back. In my young days, when I used to go and play dominoes by Brother Perino. Brother Simmons, he had just been introduced to the community. He was contemplating marriage, but he was always present at the domino table down by Brother Perino. In those days, we would go there from afternoon time, and that was our pastime. If it's not cricket, we go to play like a dominoes, and so we stay there until a certain time. But he is a gentleman, he was a gentleman who did not speak much. He did not speak much, but he was passionate about whatever he did. And in fact, when you could have seen him, the happiest is when you see he won a domino and he gave a sapat. Especially he gave a sapat to the older men who thought they were untouchable. At those days, the older men like Brother Perino, Brother Sillery, and others, you know, they felt that we were much younger and we were not supposed to win a game. But Simmons was deep in his thinking in the dominoes. And so often, when he would have given that sapat to Brother Sinri and Brother Perino sometimes, they would say, game over, everybody go home. You know, but we didn't take it for nothing. We continued coming back. But at that time, Simmons was seeing somebody, a relative of mine. His ex-wife, who is Agnes. And so I happen to have been closely related to him. Well, not related, but we often would be speaking together. And he was not a man, as I say, of many words, but he was persistent. That's where he wanted to go. And so after a few years and months, they came together and they were married. But what I remember more about Simmons is his church life. He was that devoted churchgoer, member of the Seventh-day Adventist Church in Labe, although he lived all the way down in Cicero. He would travel here regularly on the Sabbath day, every Sabbath. If you don't see Simon, he's either overseas or he's really sick. And that was seldom. And not just being here, but he would be here early. When all those who have transport, who lives next door, those who open the church, he would even be there before those who open the church. Because that's one thing about him. He believed in time. He was a principled individual. He believed in a lot of principles. And so Simmons would be here very early in the morning. And not just come here just for coming sick. He loved the lesson study. He was occupying Brother Jonge's class. Brother Jonge was the one who was supposed to have been doing the tribute. He was first with Brother Lufa Thomas, who was his teacher, and then Brother Jonge. But Simmons was there regularly on a Sabbath, and he didn't come empty-handed or didn't have something to say. He would study his lesson, and he was prepared for battle on the Sabbath day, defending what he had studied and what he believed in. He stood firm in that. In spite of some difficulties in his life and things didn't go as he was planning, he persisted and trusted in God. And that's one of the things I could tell you about him. He persisted and trusted in God. Even during the time of the pandemic, when the church was virtually closed and it was only those who were participating in order for him to screen and to broadcast the service, he would be here. He would come regularly. No transport. He would stand by the road and he would get his bus to the morn, get another one down to Cicero. And so Simmons was there. Another noticeable thing about him, and I emulate that from him, the way he kept himself. He always tell me that you need to walk with your shoulders up. If you have nothing to worry about, don't put your head down. Walk with your head up and your shoulders up. And he was well known for a man who was upright, the way he walked. His physique tells it all, that he was a man who was upright. I've never known him to have any difficulty with people and things of that sort. I don't know everything about him, I must admit. But from what I know about him, he represented himself well. He represented God's people well. And even the Sabbath before he passed away, I remember meeting him at the door and speaking to him. I tell him, well, I'm not going down. Often he would ride with me when I lived in Cicero full time. But I tell him, well, I'm not going down today. He tell me, it's okay. I'm just happy to see you. How is everything? We spoke for a little while. And then on that following Tuesday or so, I was shocked to hear about that because he looked good. He looked good. But rest assured, we believe that he lived a life pleasing to the Lord. And we look forward on resurrection morning to see our brother, our friend, our father, our cousin, whatever he is to you. We look forward to seeing him once again. And we pray that you will get strength to go on because we believe that he lived a good life. God bless you.
We have someone down to do the eulogy. Can you please come forward? Okay, even as the person comes up, I just want to give one little tribute about Brother Simon. I think it is interesting that it's very important that I say it. I have been in the Labe Church for a few years, and I always noticed Brother Simon sitting at the back, and I never had a conversation with him. But the last Sabbath that he visited Labe, he came to Labe. I saw him by the road waiting for a bus, and I stopped. Something is saying to me that you need to have a conversation with this gentleman. He's very quiet. He seems to be such a nice man. I stopped and I wind my windows down. I said to Mr. Simon, I didn't know his name, but I said to him, can I offer you a ride lower down? He said to me, no problem. So upon coming, I asked him, where exactly are you going? He said to me, he's going down to Cul-de-sac. And I said, oh. I told him that I was only reaching at the Sarat Gap. I thought he was living somewhere in the Bexar area. I could have dropped him there. But because of circumstances, I could not go all the way to Cul-de-sac. And I left. And I thought this was my opportunity to have a conversation with him. And only a few days after, I heard that he passed. And it touched me. He said, Lord, I had this opportunity. I should have just gone all the way down with this gentleman. And it really pained me when I knew that he died. And I never had that conversation which I really wanted to have with him. Such a wonderful human being. May God bless his family. I hope his lifestyle has been a great example for the friends, relatives who knew him and who have been very close to him. And by your attendance, it makes me know that his life touched many of you. Thank you very much for turning up.
Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome, family and friends, and thank you for joining us today. We gather here not to mourn, but to celebrate the life of a great man, Simeon James, known to many as Mr. Simmons. To me, he was Uncle Simmons. He may not have been famous or rich, but he was an inspiration to his children, who respected him and appreciated having a father figure in their lives. He taught them the power of love and to live and enjoy their lives. Born January 7th, 1947, to Mathryn Wilson, better known as Septilia or Cecet of Monrepeau. He was actually born to Mathryn James, who eventually became Septilia Wilson. He left home at the age of 18 to pursue what was not planned, but became a very successful carpenter. To the day of his death, he was very passionate about his skills, be it masonry, plumbing, and the list goes on. He basically was a jack of all trades. Anyone who wanted a house built or even small works around the house done would know where and how to find him. Ask Alistair. He single-handedly built her house. When he first moved to Cass Trees, he lived in Lastic Hill with his aunt, where he met Sandra Charles, the mother of his first offsprings, Delphina, Susanna, and Anthony. Things didn't go quite as planned, and as a result, he moved to L'Abbaye, where he met and was confused by Miss Agnes Senville, and they had two children and got married, Callista James and Troy James. During that union, he met his Lord and Savior and decided to follow him till the time of his death. Simmons made it his duty to be at church every Saturday, as has been testified here before, and always encouraged his children and grandchildren to follow. He would quote every scripture, every verse, with confidence and pride. Later on in his life, since his union did not work out, he moved to Cicero, which later brought him his last three children, Junior, Simonia, and Isabella James. Carpentry was his source of income, but his passion for dominoes was inexplicable. Every day after work on an afternoon, wherever you found a game of dominoes, you would find him playing with his friends and neighbors. He loved the game so much that it earned him the nickname Febo. The more he was called that name while he played, the stronger he got. Reading his Bible at the top of his lungs every single morning by 5 a.m. was the norm. Neighbors up the hill had made it their morning routine. They listened to him, engrossed in the word. His death was sudden and a shock to us all. We all felt bad about the way he passed, not saying goodbye, not giving a sign or warning. What we have now are our warmest memories of him, his love for his family, his children. His grandchildren and great-grandchildren was apparent in everything he did. Running up and down in the balcony every Sunday with Christy and Phoebe, his two great-grandchildren. His long chats with Cousin Colvin on a morning during his breakfast, chats with his daughter Delphina and her children over lunch, and numerous conversations with his daughter Callista and her family at dinner time. He was welcomed and loved by many. He was a quiet, patient, and hardworking man who wanted all that was good for his children and shared with them his strong faith in God. In his words, he lived a life where he was happy. He had no stress and saw his generations. Today, the attendance here speaks volumes as to the many lives he touched and impacted. Thank you all for being here today, and may he continue to live in each of our hearts. But I swear to you, if you pass by the Moshi bus stand, you will see him sitting there playing dominoes. I thank you.
We now call on Janita Charles to our scripture reading.
Brothers, brothers and sisters, we do not want you to be uninformed about those who sleep in death, so that you do not grieve like the rest of mankind, who have no hope. For we believe that Jesus died and rose again, and so we believe that God will bring with Jesus those who have fallen asleep in him. Amen.
Good afternoon, everyone.
Forgotten, when you feel you're all alone, when you feel like giving up, when you feel discouraged and everything's uncertain, when you feel you're just not good enough, when it's slipping through your hands and you've done all you can and there's still so much more to do, it's easy to forget in times like this. Jesus loves you. Jesus loves you. And he cares about everything you're going through. Your name is engraved on the palm of his hands, and that's a promise you can hold on to. It's easy to forget at times like this. Jesus loves you. So when the funeral is over, the casseroles are done, and you're about as broken as can be, when the sun ain't shining and the nights are just too long, and the weight of it all drives you to your knees. Oh, I've been where you are when God just seems so far, and I needed to be reminded too. 'Cause it's easy to forget in times like this. Jesus loves you. Jesus loves you. And he cares about everything you're going through. Your name is engraved on the palm of his hands, and that's a promise you can hold on to. It's easy to forget in times like this, and that your name is engraved in the palm of his hands. But that's a promise you can hold on to. It's easy to forget at times like this. Jesus loves you. Oh, Jesus loves you.
Well, good afternoon, everybody. Well, I think I'm seeing more people than the voices that I just heard. Let's see if we can do that again. Good afternoon, everybody. All ye saints from Cicero and all ye saints from every corner, I join to say welcome to each and every one. It's not always easy to say welcome at a funeral. You know, it's easier to do that at a party or some sort of celebration. But it's a little more difficult to say welcome to a funeral, because people are not in the mood of celebration. They are more in the mood of sorrow and grief and pain. And sometimes they are so focused on memories past that it just doesn't hit you that, you know, a situation like this, a welcome remark can be welcoming. But nonetheless, I am delighted to be with you and to share in this moment. And one of the things about death is that we all have an appointment with it without cancellation, except that the Lord Jesus Christ, based on the sayings of Scripture, show up before all of us die, because he can. And just in case you've never heard, the latest news about Jesus is that he is coming again. And if I don't get to that part of the sermon, let me get it in now. Please get ready to meet him, for he is coming again. There's no doubt about it. The prophecies are all fulfilling, telling us that Jesus is near. And if COVID has not nudged you into realizing that something drastic is about to happen, then start asking for revelation. Because all around us, we are seeing handwritings on the walls that are telling us something explosive is about to happen. And we who read the scriptures, with confidence we declare that the next thing that is about to happen is a zipping open of the sky, a blast in the blues, the appearance of a glory that we have never seen before, and everybody will probably think that it's time for a new weather forecast, when in truth and in fact, not even the best of the forecasters, except they're in the Lord Jesus Christ, can tell what is happening. But we Christians who believe in the Word of God, we already know what will happen on that day. It's not a sign of the change of weather naturally, it's a sign of the change of life. For it says, the Lord himself shall descend with a shout from heaven with the voice of the archangel. And Revelation says that, behold, I make all things new. And one of the glorious things about it is that the Lord Jesus Christ has made provisions through his death so that all of us can be saved on that day. And when we get there, there will be no more need to pay rents. Our rents will never be due. Well, that's good news, and I thought you'd say amen. Some of us can't even meet our rents, man. I remember living in a house where people almost tried to throw me and my mother and my four brothers out, you know, because we didn't pay the rent. But in glory, you know, rents will not be due because God has gone in Christ Jesus to prepare a place for all of us. What a marvelous promise. And so I want to encourage all of us to get ready for that day. On behalf of the church, I want to extend, on behalf of the lead team and the members of the church, our deepest and sincerest condolences to the family of our deceased brother, Brother Simeon. As was stated in the tribute, he was a wonderful person. I don't particularly remember having a rich encounter with him like Brother Emmanuel had, but nonetheless, there is something about the Christian. When they live truly in Christ, you don't have to worry about their repetition. And it's not that they are perfect, and maybe this is not the time we can never claim perfection on behalf of our brother, but that's not what it's all about when it comes to the gospel. The Bible says the Lord Jesus Christ came to save sinners, of which all of us are chief. Amen? All of us were born in sin and shapen in iniquity. And sometimes what we fool ourselves into believing is that our social status and the acquirements of life, riches, and material gain gives us, some of us, right over others. But here before us, we have a very clear demonstration of how equal we are. We may not be equal in possession, but when death strolls in, we all are equal. And we all go to the same place, even though we may decorate the tombs with colors and other things, but we become elements for the vermins. That's what it is. And when you think of that, it should make us conscious of our need for each other. And so this thing about living with bad neighbors doesn't make any sense. This thing about not treating your family well doesn't make any sense. This thing about living your life rancorously, it doesn't make sense. And there are some people, when they come to the point of death, the circumstances that sometimes cause their death, they read things into these things and want to blame people for their death, because if you have a rotten breast or something is rotting on you, the tendency is to think that somebody did you something. No, nobody did you anything. You just lived your life not according to how God wants you to live your life, because God doesn't want you to have pain. And if you're in Christ Jesus, all the claims and powers of the enemy are nullified. You're a child of God. And all blessedness are now within your reach. You see, some people don't know that, but Brother Simeon knew that, you know, and we thank God for his faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. And so today, in the context of this funeral, I just want to share with you some words of hope. And please allow me to take my time. Hey, amen? I won't keep you any longer than you deserve to be here. Amen? Hallelujah. All right, let us pray. Eternal God and our loving Heavenly Father, we deem it a privilege that we can come into your presence. We thank you, dear Lord, for the Word of God that is so pregnant with words of hope, words that abound beyond our sorrows and bring us joy. The living hope, the powerful hope, the unstoppable hope of the Lord Jesus Christ, when he shall ride the clouds of glory a second time with brilliance and splendor to come to receive his loved ones. Make us to know your words. Cast out the spirit of doubt. And every spirit that is against your word, we pray that you bring them into subjection to your will. And we pray that you place them beneath your feet. So that in this room, we will begin to realize that there is plenty of love for all of us. There is plenteous joy for all of us. There is plenteous forgiveness for all of us because Jesus is in this room. And we thank you for being here, Lord, by your Holy Spirit. In Christ's name we pray. Amen and amen. From the brief account of Brother Simeon James's life, it reflects many references of goodness, references of care, loving attention given to his family, friends, and neighbors. In many ways, it would seem he sought to live in alignment with God's will for humanity, to be a good person to his family, a good person to his friends, and a good person to others. It is often referenced in the scripture, said in the scripture, that the name of a good person lingers, but the name of the wicked rots. It's amazing that there have been some funerals that I've conducted, and depending on how the person lived, his or her life, people are in no hurry to drop their loved ones recklessly in the grave. They want to do it with a smooth. Because of how the person treated them, how the person related to them, sometimes they don't even want to bury them. They wish they could take them back home. But because of uncontrolled circumstances, they need and must put them in the jaws of the death, of the grave. Others, there is a quick intention to bury them because the references of their lives doesn't speak of goodness. They live their lives in ways that were questionable, troublesome, bothersome. They were, in some instances, categorized as a regret to life. I know a woman who said to her son, "It is better that I planted coconut trees before I brought you into this world." That's how terrible it could be. And when that guy died, they were in a haste to get rid of him. Speaks to the fact that the wise man Solomon said, "The name of the righteous shall be made in everlasting remembrance, but the name of the wicked will rot and will be forgotten." It's amazing. Your life, the way you live it, will determine how people will respond to you, even at the point of death. And I would rather suspect that if we were to give license to use this church to present memories of Brother Simon, if domino playing was an act of worship, then the church will be filled with dominoes. Would you say amen? I even think there are some guys by the gate playing dominoes. And it must be in remembrance of this great guy. And of course, I was wondering if it was alcohol they were selling out there. At least I go and stop them because the premise of the church is not for the sale of alcohol. But what I was told, it was dominoes. I said, well, okay, that one can go. You know? So it was same as though his habit of visiting families and making honest effort to provide, give attention to family needs, showing loving concern for his children and the grandchildren. They are indicators of a man that was humane, had a humane side, a side of caring for other men. One evening when I called so that we can discuss the funeral, Calesta, Delphia, and her daughter, Juanita, and precious little Christy, began providing me with much recall of special times spent and moments spent with their father and grandfather. Of course, I was not able to document all the sayings, but they were pretty good references of how we related to. Thank you. Of how he related to the people who are nicest and closest to him. They told me about those small projects in the community, those playful moments with their grandchildren running across the balcony with them. not necessarily seeking to provide joy for himself, but to provide some kind of comfort and acceptance and bonding with his grandchildren. And of course, they spoke about those lunchtime dates at Delphia's house and other places. And these came across to me as valuable reminders written in the minds of those who were closest to him. More than that, his life at church, as was given by L.A. Emanuel and a little bit in the eulogy, somewhat in the eulogy, his life at church revealed a consistency that is rare. He seemed not to have treated church casually. Church was an important and sacred part of his life, and he seemed to have dealt with matters relating to his religion with dispatch, commitment, and consecration. We need more of these types when it comes to matters of church, because church is supposed to help people to become purposeful in living and allowing them opportunities to connect with the great I Am, the one who loves us with an everlasting love and will never leave us nor forsake us. It also allows us to understand our obligation to one another, to be able to learn to love each other intentionally and deliberately and to do no harm to each one. This is what the love of God does when it is enshrined in the hearts of believers. We live at peace with each other as best as we can. And when we can't live at peace with others, we don't turn to hate. We continue to love and leave it in God's hand. I can stand here before you and tell you of stories about my life when in my encounter with individuals that I got to the point where I could not live peaceably with them again, I turned it over to God. And I was amazed how what I could not do, what God did. Some of these individuals have returned to be able to confess how wrong they were to me and how much of a blessing my life has been to them. This is what religion is supposed to do. Religion is not supposed to make you naked. Religion is supposed to make you covered. To robe you with the garments of peace, the garments of righteousness. Religion, true religion, it's not supposed to make you a busybody in other people's business. True religion allows you to focus internally and not to become so obsessed with other people's business that you have nightmares in the night. Religion is supposed to transform your life when you encounter God. The scripture would have us to understand in 1 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 16 that if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. It's not an experience where today you accept him and in that moment all things become new. You are registered as a new individual in the kingdom of God, and in that state you are justified, born as sinners, estranged from God. But when he places you in the experience of justification, he restores friendship with you. Once a stranger, now a son. John chapter 1 and verse 12 says, for as many as received him, to them he gave power. He gives you the legal right to become sons and daughters of God. Now in all your behavior, you may not always reflect the trueness of being a son of God, for it is known among us that when a particular child does not behave the way a parent modeled before him a life of goodness, then people raise this question and they ask, how is this boy, how is this girl don't behave like their parents? Because you see, when you come from a particular family, there is a certain brand that marks you in that family. So it is in the family of God. When you become a child of God, there is a certain brand that is placed on you. A legal brand. People may not believe that you are a child of God, but that's not what God thinks. You see, because most people think of you in the context of your behavior and your reputation, you know? And given time, reputation can change. But when God looks at you, he doesn't look at you in terms of your reputation. He looks at you in terms of your character. And what God knows about your character may not be known about by anyone else. And what God knows when it comes to matters of character, that cannot change on the pages of God's accounting book. And that is the reason why he gives us the guarantee that as many as received him, to them he gave the legal right to become sons and daughters of God. So when I was baptized at age 9, some people thought that I was too early, too young to be baptized. But I gave my life to the Lord Jesus Christ. And the truth about it, at that age, I was sufficiently informed that there was somebody powerful that had loved me like nobody else did. And I felt the urge to give my life to that person. And I declare today his name is Jesus. Would you say amen? You may not love him, but you'll not go to hell if you call his name. Amen? And ever since that age, that tender age of 9, I have had ups and downs in my life. But God has not given up on me. And when I look back on my life, I can declare Yahweh is to be praised for the goodness and the good things that he has done in my life. And the truth about it is that I am not worthy or deserving of his love. So here's a powerful declaration that can be a takeaway for you today. If you don't love Jesus, he will still love you. Because love does not select people to love. It loves even when you are not lovely. Have you ever seen the rain fall on only a good man's house? No. The rain falls on everybody's house. Everyone, that's a clear indication that whether you love God or not, he is going to send the rain for you. Have you ever seen the sun shine in Chosel and don't shine anywhere else? No, it shines everywhere. And so some people are not even aware that while their actions and their lifestyle indicate clearly sometimes that they are estranged from God, they don't realize that every plate of food that they eat is stamped with the blood of Jesus Christ. So even if you don't love him, he will love you. And by the way, let me propose to you that if you don't want to love him, leave him for me. I'll love him for me and for you. Hallelujah. The marvelous things that he has done. So in the context of this brother's life, we can declare that from the accounts, the reports given, that he was seemingly an amazing person. And you know, as I ran the accounts and the conversation with the family members on that day, I was looking for physical signs, psychological signs to decide to some extent how deep the grief in this family was. And the truth is, except that they pretended on me, and I don't think they did, because you don't pretend on the pastor, he's going to perceive you. They seem to have had a balance of grief and love and joy. Calexia was robust in her laughter, confident in her countenance. Delphia stood at the back of her, and as I conversed, she was laughing and reminding us of some of the things that were special to her. And of course, Christy was giving waves as she confirmed that some of the things that were said, if not all of them, were meaningful, you know, and I fell in love with Christy right there. And then if your mother would allow me, I'll take you to my house and treat you well. Are you going to come live with me? And your daddy too, you know, and your daddy too, you know. Who would not love a little girl like that? Who would not? And so, here are some considerations that I'd like to share about this dead brother. When someone like Brother Simeon dies, it leaves family members brooding in sorrow and grief. They feel a sense of loss, and the burden can be so heavy. Just knowing this person's meaningful presence is not going to be with them anymore, an empty chair, can fill them with a sense of loss. It was a wise man, Solomon, however, who, in writing about the removal of the presence of a loved one by death, has something to say about it, and he kids us not. Here's what he says in Proverbs chapter 9, Ecclesiastes chapter 9, verse 5 and 6. He says, "For the living know that they shall die, but the dead knows not anything." They don't know anything. So this dead brother lying in the coffin, according to the wise man Solomon, inspired scripture, he does not know anything. He doesn't even hear. Can't speak, he can't move, can't talk, can't smell, can't breathe. He knows not anything because he is dead. The breath in his nostril is gone. He can't breathe anymore. And there is no inquiry of him. You know, I know of people who have not read the scripture and have imbibed beliefs where they were thought that after a certain period of the burial, you can go to the burial ground and communicate with the dead. I don't have the time to tell you, but that is not a biblical teaching. The scripture is clear that when a person is dead, they don't know anything. So you ask me, Pastor, then who is it that I saw the other night after the burial? What kind of perfume did I smell that night? Wasn't it the same perfume that we sprayed him with? Yes, you did. But the question is, who is it that you saw or encounter? Revelation tells us that the enemy has the power to impersonate the dead, especially if they die outside of Christ, because he has power over that life. And that's why I don't dream about my mother, because she is in the grave as a saved saint, and I can hardly wait to meet her again. Woman who sacrificed and sweat, blood, and tears to get her four sons through, who are just eaters and sometimes very lazy. I said sometimes. But the dead knows not anything. The dead knows not anything. But more than that, it says, neither have there any more a reward for their works. So you can't go to the burial ground with bottles of juice and conclude that they are thirsty, so let me give them some water. No. No. They can't participate. More than that, it says, the reason why they can't deal with rewards or anything is because their memories are all forgotten. So the dead can't think. The dead knows not anything. There is no registration of any good memory that they have had with you, and you can't call them into existence to talk to them about these memories. No, that is the reason why when people are alive, we must live well. I hasten to tell you why. Some of the funerals that I've conducted, I've seen people dress up in garments of mourning, real garments of mourning, and they come to the funeral, and they bawl all hell down. And you would think that they had such a powerful relationship with this person that sometimes if you don't have the spirit of discernment, you're fooled into believing that they really had a tight thing going with this brother, a tight thing going with this sister. But when you pull them into the room of therapy and you begin to probe and find out, try to find out, why is it that you are so emotionally broken over this dead brother, this dead sister? And then when you create the right ambience and get them talking, you begin to discover that they have unfinished business with that person. And now the person is dead, the memories are closed, and they can't reconcile. So they come bawling down as if bawling is going to settle the differences. Now, that's why Jesus says, forgive ye one another of your wrongs. Settle your accounts before people close their eyes. Because after they close their eyes, their memories are forgotten and they have no part. Let me just read this for you. He says also, after he says their memories are forgotten, he says also their love. Their what? Their love. And their hatred. If they went to the grave with bitterness in their hearts, their love and their hatred, and their envy, if they had that, is now perished. Neither have they any more a portion. Let me read that slowly. Neither have they any more a portion forever in anything that is done under the sun. Now, if the dead had power, some of you would not be sitting here. Because maybe some of you have money for Brother Simeon that you didn't pay. Well, the family is alive and they may need it to clear the expense of the burial. So show up and be honest. I'm putting in something for you there, Callister, with much love. You know, I suspect these are the brothers, right? The sons, right? Don't make the sons turn on you. Huh? These guys look very strong and capable, you know. Yeah, yeah. So settle your debts, because when somebody dies, they can't love you again. Their love is forgotten. They can't hate you again, you know. And their envy is now forgotten. It's now perished. Neither have they any more a portion forever. Help me, Jesus. Forever in anything. They can't come to your wedding. They can't come to your birthday party. I've gone to weddings and celebration points where somebody remembers a mother or father who was so sweet, but now are dead. And then somebody says, she is here. No. Anything, anyone that is there, the scripture says, these are spirits of devils working miracles. So the devil has the power because God didn't take it away from him and he cast him out of heaven. So he's there loaded with power, except that his power is defeated through the blood of the everlasting covenant that was spilt on Calvary for the remission of our sins. So Satan can't pass the bloodline. Can't pass the bloodline. So the dead must not know anything. Can't participate in anything. So whenever they say, he or she is here, I know that they didn't read this passage in the Bible. Because if they read it, they wouldn't say it. But more than that, our dear loved ones will not be with us again in any form or fashion. They are committed to the grave and remain there until the second glorious coming of the Lord Jesus Christ at the end of time. Paul had some very comforting words to share on occasions like that, suit occasions like these. He says, for if we believe, because you can choose not to believe. And by the way, Christ died on Calvary's cross to give you the freedom to choose him or not. That's what love does. Love gives people choice. If you are married and your husband not giving you a choice, then you're not in a marriage. You're under control. Amen. So when I tell men I don't control my wife, love doesn't have to control. Let me tell you a secret. This is not for funeral, but I don't know if I'm going to meet you again. Men, let me tell you a secret. You can drop some offering with this guy after the funeral if you're so moved. People pay me a lot of money to say this. A woman has no right to submit to any man except he first loves her. Now that's radical because we grew up in a culture that didn't teach us that. It is on the basis of loving a woman that she submits to you. So the more you love, the more she submits. Abraham loved Sarah so much, she submitted to him to the point where she called him Lord. Respect. Some men are calling for respect, but they're not loving. And of course, there are some women who are so branded they don't submit even the man, even though the man loves. You need to visit the cross. I thought the men would respond this time. They're still thinking of what I've just said. Yeah, there are some women. They don't fight to control men, but they use their intuitive ability to control men's pocket, control men's mind. And some men don't know that. But that's for another time when I announce the seminar for that, right? So the Apostle Paul says, for if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so them also which sleep, because that's what death is. Even those who sleep in Jesus will God bring with him. For this we say unto you, by the word of the Lord, not my word, the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain, hallelujah, for the Lord himself, not another, the Lord, the Lord himself, did I say that correctly? The Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trumpet of God. That to me doesn't sound secret. That doesn't sound like a rapture that is secret. Noise. And listen to what it is. He shall descend with a shout. Not with a whisper. Not in some quiet corner. A shout. Do you know what is a shout? Listen. Do you know together we have the capacity, we shout in unison, the roof goes off? When the people were going around Jericho's wall, when they shouted, the walls came down. A shout with the voice of the archangel. Huh.
and with the trump of God. And it's going to be so powerful that it will be filled, that noise is going to be filled with resurrection power. Because here's what it says. And the dead in Christ shall rise first. But that's not all. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together to meet him in the air, in the clouds, to meet the Lord in the air. And so shall we ever be with the Lord. Wherefore, comfort one another with these words. There are some people, and they might be here today, I say this much lovingly, who believe a lie, and they don't know it. They think that heaven is right here. Heaven and hell is right here. That's not true. That is not true. I mean, life may be sweet, and we can call that heaven. Life can be sour, and we can call it hell. But when the Bible speaks about heaven and hell, it's not talking about that. It is talking about place, a place, two different and opposite places where people are going to end up, finally. If you are in Christ, hallelujah, you go to glory. If you are not in Christ and in the other wicked brother, you go to hell. And listen, the Bible teaches that hell is a place of fire. Now you ask me, if God is love, why did he provide hell? Well, let me tell you. Let me tell you. Do you want to continue to live in misery? Do you want to have COVID for the rest of your life for all eternity? But did you know that is what the devil wanted? Yes. That's why after the temptation and the fall, the God of heaven placed an angel at the tree of life to bar the way so that Adam and Eve do not go to the tree of life and eat and become immortal sinners to suffer eternal punishment and eternal suffering and eternal fever and eternal everything. So Christ has broken that power. And eternal sin and sinfulness would exist forever. And when a people or a nation lives so much in sin, because there is such a thing, the social scientists would want us to believe that it is social engineering. No. Sin is something that is in all of us, and only Jesus can conquer it. You know? So what happened with God and the plan of salvation is that when people in a community or a nation live so recklessly that they are passing on wickedness to every incoming generation, they make the society unfit to live in. And that's when Jesus, in love, comes and clean it up and start all over again. That's why there is hell. So that Satan can be destroyed, sin can be destroyed, and those who do not give their lives to the Lord Jesus, they also will be destroyed. But here's the good news. Hell was not made for you. It was made for the devil and the angels. But if you follow the devil, you'll get there. In the name of Jesus today, I place a bar of resistance on that. All of us need to get to heaven. Make that choice today. It doesn't matter how far you have gone in sin. There is no sin that is so deep that God can't forgive. He says, where sin abound, grace that much more abound. So if you came in here today with 20 million tons of sin and you're so guilty, you're pretending that you're all right, but you're rotten on the inside because sin is messing you up. The very thing that you don't want to do is the very thing you fall a captive to. You want to go left, but something pulling you right. You know it in your mind that you shouldn't treat your husband like that. But you still do it. Yeah. So that God is taking care of. He is taking care of that. And so let me haste to say to you, not only will the family, in the context of this coming of Jesus, he says, we will meet the Lord in the air. And there would be no aircraft to do that. We would just defy the laws of gravity. Nothing to keep me back. Nothing to hold my body down. The power of God removes gravity. And now, like in the first time in all my life, in the redeemed of the Lord, We sail into the presence of God. There is something much more to that, but we don't have the time for that. Let me hasten to share something else with you. So, the Apostle Paul says, with this hope that I've just shared with you, comfort one another with these words. In another place, he says, weep not as others who do not have hope. Yes, the Christian will have some hard times, some bad times. And I know some of you, as you look at me and listen to the word of God, some of you have had sleepless nights. Some of you, suicidal thoughts have paraded your mind only because of the grace of God. You didn't pull that rope. He has been watching over you. Somewhere in your mind, in spite of the fact that the pleasure of death begin to supersede your pleasure for living, somewhere in the crack of your brain, you remembered somebody reading for you at church while you were not paying attention. It slipped into your subliminal subconscious dimension and it got stuck there for that time. When you were about to get it done, that voice, you heard it. It says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. And you begin to reflect on that. You see, lots of conversion don't take place in church, you know. It takes place under the crucible of suffering and pain and hardship. That's where it begins. And so he says, comfort one another with these words. Not only will the family feel a sense of loss, but the families and friends in the community that got their houses built and their steps fixed and their house painted and their plumbing done, they too, who have benefited from Brother Simeon's living presence, they too will feel they have lost a good friend and a favored member of their community. As a result of this loss, there is an aching void and someone needs emotional comfort and healing caused by this loss. So in the words of the Apostle Paul that we just read, we find some comforting insight of the pain caused by death. However, he also provided hope for the children of God when facing death. He clearly indicated that death is an unconscious sleep, number one. Number two, Jesus will come and will awaken the children of God from this sleep of death. The dead will be raised from their slumber in the grave. Number three, this will happen at the second glorious coming of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah to the Lamb of God. God promised he will raise them and they will be with him forever. At the closure or the conclusion of his word, the Apostle Paul encourages all believers to have hope in this confident words. This we say to you by the word of the Lord. The word of scripture, he bids them to take and offer comfort to each other with this blessed hope. Wherefore, meaning therefore, comfort one another with these words. It's amazing how many grieving animals grieve when they experience the death of a fellow from their flock, especially when the death is tragic. Research looked at features of the brain in the living animal before the death of a member of the flock and after the death of a member of the family of the flock or the group of sheep. There are observable changes, they say, in the structure of the brain when grief strikes. The normalcy of the brain changes. And they take that and apply that principle to human beings, and they discover that when human beings are in distress, the function and structure of the brain changes from that which produces, from a position that produces joy to a position that chooses sorrow and grief and pain. So a flock of sheep, when one dies tragically, will gather around that sheep and they would bleat gently. They would mourn gently. Mourn in their sadness. And then the shepherd picks that up For so must a shepherd do. A shepherd must know when the sheep is mourning, when the sheep has suffered loss. So the shepherd comes by and he sits among the sheep, the bleating sheep, close to the dead sheep, the victim of the tragedy. And he begins to administer comfort for the sad and broken flock of sheep. In the face of death, when it bites like an adder and hurts us deeply, it causes change in the function of the brain and produces emotional pain and grief at the loss of a dear loved one like Simeon. So in today's brokenness at this funeral, being experienced by family members and community members who profited from his life, the Apostle Paul points our attention, the psalmist rather, points our attention to our loving shepherd, a comforter of comforters. It says, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley overshadowed with death, I'll fear no evil." Why? Because the Eternal One fights our battles against death. His name is Jah, the Everlasting, the Unconquerable One, who rides on the horse of victory with its swords drawn and declares the last enemy that shall be destroyed is death. And he wields that sword in defense of all those who believe in him. And he conquers everyone. Yes, the Eternal One. His name is Jah. He is the Eternal Warrior. He wars not for himself, but he wars for his people. That's why I'm not afraid. You kill me, you can only take my body, but you can't destroy what God has given to me. So therefore, today, make the Lord your shepherd in the face of death. Our shepherd provides, because it says, "Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For thou art with me, thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me." Here it comes again. Comfort me. A comforter is one who stays with you in the midnight when you're facing the tundra of coldness and loneliness, rejection, depression, and all the other negative things. He comes by and he comforts. And there are some times when your enemies will prepare danger for you. But here's what the shepherd does. "Thou preparest a table before me in the very presence of my enemies." That's why in the face of this enemy, you can rejoice and have hope. Then it says, "Thou anointest my head with oil." The pain of losing a loved one. I will anoint your head. He anoints our head with oil and causes our cups to overflow. Who is not enjoying this stuff? This is not Buju Banton. Eh? This is Jesus, the Savior of the world. He anoints your head with oil. Don't let them fool you, young people. There are going to be some times in life when the circumstances of life will bring so much pain to your head. You think life was fantasy? It's now real. But he will anoint your head. That wayward child that is causing you problem, he will anoint your head. That husband that is indifferent to all the good things that you have done, he will anoint your head. That wife that is so careless, she's a busybody in other people's business and don't have time to take care of you, and your head pains, he anoints your head with oil. So in the face of all of this, he says, "Goodness and mercy shall follow you all the days of your life." And watch this now. And then finally, when it's done, "You will dwell in the house of God forever." I heard somebody sing, "This world is not my own. I'm just passing through." Yes, we don't belong here. As I close this afternoon, I want to tell you that in the face of death, your shepherd provides some amazing comfort for your aching soul. He provides peace for our sad and broken hearts. He provides refreshing waters from the springs of life for a thirsty soul. He provides safe path of rightness for our weary stumbling feet. He provides healing and rest and restores our soul from hurt and pain because he has, somebody said, weeping may endure but for a night, but joy, great joy, wonderful joy comes in the morning. He provides courage and takes away the evil of our fears when death parades and makes us afraid. We have the guarantee of his presence, for his rod and his staff will comfort us. Hallelujah. He provides abundance of food for us right in the very presence of our enemies. He provides anointing for our aching head from the oil of his anointing jar. He will provide the watchdog of goodness and mercy to watch us while the enemy is prowling to snap at us. Angels will be there to protect you. Oh, yes. And finally, when all is done and our trials are done, it will be done. We will be escorted into the presence of God, and there we shall live forevermore. And then, like the old Negro spiritual, together we'll be able to sing, "Free at last, free at last. Thank Almighty God, we are free at last." So until then, we can sing. When peace like a river attendeth my way. Sing it with me. When sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot, thou hast taught me to say, it is well, it is well with my soul, it is well with my soul, it is well, it is well with my soul. And Lord, haste. And Lord, haste the day when thy fate shall be sight. The clouds be rolled back as a scroll. Hallelujah. The trump shall resound, and the Lord shall descend. Even so, it is well with my soul. It is well with my soul. It is well. It is well with my soul. Lord, we ascribe praise, glory, and honor to you. We worship and celebrate. In the face of death, we honor you for the glorious privilege and promise of life anew. We adore you, dear God, for being the one who comforts Israel. Comfort ye, O people. Comfort ye, saith the Lord. We are glad, dear God, that when others forsake and our hearts are aching, when our dear loved one are closed within the walls of the grave and we see them no more, we look forward to the glorious resurrection morning when the Lord Jesus Christ himself will break forth with the brilliance of a million sunshine, and the mossy old graves where the pilgrims sleep shall be open as wide as before, and the millions that sleep in the mighty deep will live on this earth once more. Oh Lord, we are thankful to thee that today in this funeral you are recruiting people for the kingdom of God. I believe that there is somebody here today. There are many people here who have contemplated, have chosen, and are still trying to make up their mind about the promises of eternal God. Spirit divine, fall afresh upon your people and make this promise real as the noonday sun. Thank you for being with us. Thank you for the family. Bless and keep us, O Lord. Guide and let the word of God fall within the realms of our heart and never to be moved. We pray it and we give you thanks in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Now, that was just the prayer for the sermon. We now have the prayer for the family. Amen. And as soon as the prayer is done, I'll ask those who are responsible for signing the book to meet me across that table over there so that we can do that. And then we're almost on our way.
At this point in time, I will invite the family members to stand, and all those who want to be associated in supporting the family during this difficult time, I'll also ask you to stand whilst we pray. Let's bow our heads in prayer. Almighty Father, Majesty of heaven and earth, dear Lord, in the name of your Son, Jesus, our Savior, we bow in your holy presence once again this afternoon. Oh Lord, we come to you because we know that in you there is strength. In you there is comfort. In you there is hope. And whereas our earthly parents and other friends cannot always help us with the difficulties of life, we know that we could count on you, oh Lord, because you are the creator. You are the great physician. You know more about the human body and its capacity more than everybody else. And so, Lord Jesus, this afternoon we come in your name because, Lord, just before you died for us on Calvary's cross, you knew that your mother, Mary, was about to suffer much pain and agony. And you said to John, "Comfort my mother." In the same vein, we come to you this afternoon as the family continue to grieve at the loss of such a special man. Father, we pray that you would cover them with your righteousness. We pray that you would bring comfort for them, Father God, at the most difficult times, because even today they are surrounded by many persons and so they may feel strong. But Father, when the quiet moment will come, we pray that you will be with them through the person of your Holy Spirit to strengthen them. Give them comfort in knowing, O Lord, that if we live a life worthy of your calling, one day death will have no power over us, as Jesus has already conquered death. So until then, we pray that you would keep them strong, keep them rooted in the blessed hope, O Lord, that one of these good days when Jesus shall return, there'll be no more death, no more sorrow, no more sickness, no more COVID, Father God. Strengthen them in every moment. We pray for the children, the sons and daughters, the grandchildren, the cousins, the nephews and the nieces, the uncles, whatever, whoever is here today, Father God, whichever of the family members that are remaining. Comfort them in their own way, O Lord. Let them know that you are always there. When others are asleep and are away, you are always there. We thank you for the presence, your presence that is always there with us, O Lord. Strengthen us, and when we leave here, take us to our various homes safely, we pray. These are the mercies we ask in Jesus' most wonderful name. Amen. Please be seated. And those of you who will be signing the register, please meet with the pastor on my left, your right, whilst we have special song, following which we'll have the vote of thanks, and then the closing exercises will be following that very soon.
There's a place in heaven
He's preparing for me when the toils of this life will be over. When the saints all dressed in white will surround his throne, singing praises forevermore. Jesus promised me a home over there. Sorrow, no pain or death, 'cause Jesus promised me a home over there. In my Father's house, there are mansions proud. If he said it, then I know that it's true. There'll be a place for me beyond the sky. And brothers and sisters, there'll be one for you. 'Cause Jesus promised me a home over there. Jesus promised me a home over there. There'll be no more sickness or sorrow, no pain. Jesus promised me a home over there. Oh, Jesus promised me a home over there. My Jesus promised me a home over there. No more sorrow, no pain or death, 'cause Jesus, he promised me a home over there. Oh, there'll be no more sickness, no sorrow, no pain. Jesus, he promised me a home over
there. Yeah, I just want to thank Sister Steva for singing so beautifully. I don't have the time to tell you how she got here, but she has been a rescue point for this funeral in the last moment to do these specials for us. And did she not sing so beautifully? Yeah, we really do appreciate. Yeah, a round of applause is very good, Jesus. Thank you, Steva. Let's have the person to do the vote of thanks at this time.
Good afternoon, everybody.
on behalf of my family, that is the family of Mr. Simmons, I would like to thank each and every one of you for being here with us today. I would like to thank you for the words of encouragement, for your support through this difficult time. Thank you to Miss Sonia, Miss Sabina, and Dora for the assistance, and also to Cousin Colvin for being with us from the time of his death to today. Thank you.
Amen. Let me invite you to please stand so we can do the benediction. Our eternal Father in heaven, our Maker and our Creator, what a privilege and honor to be in your house of worship. We thank you, Lord, for the message that has been presented to us by your manservant. We thank you for your spirit that has used our dear pastor as he presented the word, thus saith the Lord. Thank you for your Holy Spirit, which has spoken to each and every one of us. And as we prepare to leave this place, we recognize, dear Lord, that your Holy Spirit has touched the life of many of us. We have been pricked by your word. And today, as we prepare to leave this place, may we leave with a heart that is totally surrendered to doing your will. We pray that you'll continue to comfort the family. We recognize, dear Lord, that because of the death, many are suffering and many are missing the presence of their loved one. But we have this blessed hope that one day Jesus Christ will appear in the cloud and there'll be no more suffering, no more pain. But even as we await this day, we pray that the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the sweet fellowship of the Holy Spirit will continue to rest and abide with us, both now and forevermore. Amen. Amen. As we get ready for the recessional hymn, there are a few housekeeping that I would like you to take note of. There may be a bottle of water or your umbrella you may have come into the sanctuary with. You can hold it so that you'll not leave it here at the church. As just a reminder, as we depart, we at the podium will be leading out, and the pole bearers will be followed next after, and thereafter the immediate family. The recessional hymn will be, "We Know Not the Hour."
Thank you. is that I'm under my Lord's wings. Under His wings. Under all dark clouds hung low, I was out in a storm. I could not find my way. The terrors of the night took hold. How I yearned for break of day. Then He saw my plight, and out in the night He shined His light. He called me to His side. And I ran. Was filled with danger. I felt alone. The enemy had singled me out to do me wrong. And when he drew near, my heart filled with fear. Then I heard someone dear calling me to his side. And I ran under His wings. There He covered me, and now I can see. The enemy still.
Assemble on the grave site. To lay the remains of our brother in the grave, we pray that again He will raise a message of comfort by Your presence in Jesus' name. Amen.
I'm going to read from 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 51 to 55. Behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but shall all be changed. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. So when this corruptible has put on incorruption, and this mortal has put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your sting? O Hades, where is your victory? Amen.
Inasmuch as our Lord Jesus Christ in His wisdom and the providence of Almighty God has permitted our dear brother to fall asleep in the Lord Jesus Christ, in the wisdom and promise of heaven, we now commit his body to the ground, ash to ash, dust to dust, with a sure promise of the resurrection of the last day, when our Lord Jesus Christ will come to awake the dead out of the grave, and they shall live and reign forevermore. At this time, we want to bow our heads as we pray. Eternal God and our loving Heavenly Father, we tenderly commit this body to the ground, knowing that we do so with a blessed assurance. Death is an enemy, Lord. Are we glad that in your word that this enemy shall be obliterated? And we have reasons to believe it will be soon. And that day, dear Lord, this mortal shall put on immortality. We will live forever in a state of everlasting youth. No more sorrows, no more pain, no more wrinkles in the cheeks, no more failing muscles, No more arthritis, no more diabetes, no more COVID. None of these things, the former things, shall pass away, and you will make all things new. What a promise, Lord. What a grander promise. We hold on to it in faith, not because we are deserving, but because you are merciful. And so, God, we pray that on that resurrection morning, on that grand and glorious day, together with all the saints of all the ages, Lord, who have been buried, together with him and those who shall be buried in the future, together with those of us who will be alive and will remain alive on the day of the Lord's coming, you shall put closure to death. No more funeral trains on the hillsides of glory. No more tears to cry. No more sorrows, Lord. You will bring all of this to an end. Oh God, may we be comforted with the assurance of your word. And now we pray, dear Lord, that thy will be done. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Hold strong.
If you give a little more than you take, and if you try to fix more than you break, if you're the kind who takes the time to help a stranger in the rain, there's a place for people like you. If you stand up for those down on their knees and lend a voice to those who cannot speak, if you shine a little light, give sight to the ones who've lost their way, there's a place for people like you. I've heard up there the streets are made of gold, and when you get there, there's a hand to hold. I believe when your days down here are through, there's a place up there for people like you. If you walk around with your heart on your sleeve, and if you're trying to be the change you wanna see, if you lay down your life for love so someone could be saved, there's a place for people like you. The streets are made of gold, and when you get there, there's a hand to hold. I believe when your days down here are through, there's a place up there for people like you.
Up so I can stand on mountains.
stand on mountains. You raise me up to walk on stormy seas. I am strong when I am on your shoulders. You raise me up more than I can be. You raise me up more than I can be.
Probably the only book.